Yeah, well, we got the call from our agent in New York, and he was so excited. And we were excited as well when we heard the news that, you know, that they were interested in us coming out here to Ecuador to do this amazing project.
Because I don't really like tourists, in fact. So I asked, did you want me to make commercial work or I do what I want? And she said, do what you want. So I said, oh, okay, cool, I will go at the project.
And I was like so surprised, but I'm like, yeah, that makes sense. Like it's kind of, they're from volcanoes. Like they're from, you know, it's not gonna be the most lush place.
I didn't know what to expect. I was very curious and I was very excited about the idea of coming to somewhere that I've never been before.
Ecuador, the banana.
I didn't know that much about Ecuador before I got the call.
What did I know about Ecuador?
These days, I'm calling myself a filmmaker. I'm in transition. You know, I had a full career as a photographer. I learned how to take pictures. I think my dad got me a book. It was like a $5 book that Kodak put out. It was called A Guide to 35mm SLR Photography. My favorites are always the ones who do things the hard way, and that's probably me recognizing something in myself, because I'm sort of the work harder, not smarter type.
Area right here, you see these black stalactites?
The Galapagos. I've always wanted to come here, but I didn't have a plan to come here. It's got a special place in the history of the world. So for the last little bit, I've been listening to these recordings of Darwin's On the Origin of Species. It was right there, but it's a profound discovery. Ecuador is a. It's crucial, you know. It's the home of biodiversity. If you look at the all the climates, you know, just in the mainland, it's amazing. It goes from the mountains to the coast and everything in between. It's on the belt line of the world. It's right at the center. It's amazing. So when we were on the boat ride over to Española, I went up onto the top deck, and there was a frigate bird that was pacing the boat, and it was just floating just overhead, and it was just the first rays of light of the day, and I was directly underneath shooting. I was laying on my back and shooting straight up at the bird, and it was sort of clocking left and right and panning and just catching the little bit of light from the horizon. It was beautiful. Laying on my back, shooting straight up, and having this bird. I mean, that's been the thing at so many of the places is to be able to capture images of the animals, and the animals are almost patient with you.
It looks like it's been arranged, but it's probably just exactly how it decomposed. So symmetrical.
We've seen everything that I imagined you would see in the Galapagos, and more. It feels like a place that the whole world has a vested interest in protecting. It is between the rainforest, which has all of the biodiversity. It's a privilege and a curse to own a piece of the Amazon and to own the Galapagos Islands. It's expensive to all of the work that goes into the preservation is expensive. The pressures to support the people in the Amazon is significant. You can't leave that up to just because it falls within the borders of Ecuador doesn't mean that Ecuador has to be solely responsible for preserving something that is so important to the entire planet. The Galapagos is a sacred place, and it's funny to use a word like sacred, which has a religious connotation, with a place that's tied in with the story of evolution and of science. Anyone who visits the Galapagos will feel that. Everyone will feel that.
I've been doing photography for a long time. I decided right in high school and that's what I wanted to do for a living. Passion is everything for my daily work. If I love exactly what I do, because the hours and the times and the things that we do for our work is everything. Really impressed, but not impressed. I'm really like shocked by the variety of what Ecuador has, from what everybody else got to see to what the stuff I got to see. It's just there's so much variety. cacao, I was blown away by what they can get from the fruit, to experience the plantation where they, like, they opened the cacao for me and they showed me how they made the juice. Dolphins in the mangroves, which was amazing. It was beautiful. Sunset, dolphins on the boat. It's incredible. An experience I'll remember for my entire life. And it was amazing. It was something I had never seen before.
For me, being a travel photographer is not only exploring the world, but inspiring other people to perhaps follow my footsteps and see the great things that this earth has to offer everyone else. the things that inspire me are amazing landscapes and cultures that I've not yet seen before. I've traveled around the world and every country is different to me. It kind of makes you feel very small because you're looking at the entire universe above you. But then you realize that you're part of that universe and it's kind of welcoming almost. I wouldn't say it's spiritual, but it certainly is moving. The things that I've discovered about Ecuador so far have amazed me. And now that I've spent some time in the jungle, the biodiversity here is simply mind-blowing. The number of creatures, great and small, is staggering in number. Travelling through the rainforests of Ecuador, I've constantly felt in awe, pretty much at the scale of everything. The forests seem to go on forever. Plus awe at the animals around us. We've been very lucky in seeing.
Well, a lot of the shots I did were actually from a high viewpoint, trying to get the different layers of the trees, especially early in the morning where you'd have pockets of mist and clouds just in between the trees, and that developed sort of the layers.
I think travelling to any new country or any new landscape is always worth it. Whether you like something or you dislike something, I believe you always have to see it with your own eyes. I can certainly say that I've loved Ecuador so far. And I was quite taken aback at how beautiful Mother Nature can be.
My passion for myself, I love photography. So what I try to do with my photography is have my own identity and personality within that that style. So I build up my portfolio doing exactly what I like to photograph.
That's what's great about, you know, our work, isn't it? It takes us to many different places that you never even think of going.
Just come here with an open mind, pretty much, and just enjoy the experience. And that's what we've done. We have enjoyed it.
I think for me personally, I mean, obviously the landscape, nature, because we're in the rainforest as well, that's obviously incredible. I mean, unbelievable. It's something that I've never seen before.
In the Amazon, when we walked around the forest, you know, the beams of light coming down, you know, it's amazing light and lovely dappling, everywhere. I think when you're in a new surroundings, things inspire you.
But also the people, I think, are so warm and really, really nice.
Really friendly.
Really open.
Everybody's been so generous. And
yeah.
We've had such
that
a nice
really
time.
Came through, the warmth definitely. From the people. And of course, the climate's warm as well, but the people are really warm.
Yeah, new experience.
Yeah. It's heightened, isn't it, your senses? Yeah.
Thank you.
the difference in light and textures, the scenery,
the colors,
yeah. Everything, you know, you see it in a new, it's like you got new eyes.
Mm. We're starting to getting to know a new person, yeah.
I use photography to point something. It's like a denunciation. I'm a hater. I hate everything. Not everything, but a lot of things. And it's the most lazy way, and lazy and easy way I find to make money.
As I was telling you guys, unfortunately.
All right, it's a cascade picture.
Ah, okay.
It's a new way to take pictures.
Okay.
I can say it's for pointing something. I can say it's. It's so different, depend the day. I'm really commit to my art, to my work. And I think the work I do is not really the work I do. It's the how I modify my life and how I create my life. So my art is only the output. I'm like a transfer, you know? So more I read book, more I read everything, photography is the output. My art is the output. We create what we know. If something is beautiful, I want to modify, to change it. Like the big, beautiful tree. The subject is not the big, beautiful tree. It's the bush behind. In contact with people. People think I'm not shy, but I'm kind of shy, and I use this, it's like a pretext.
Diego.
Oh.
I will make my own fashion. What is the most simple thing? A dead pixel in the middle of nowhere. So this way I try to recreate our portrait, our landscape can be seen. So it's great, like a blank sheet to create your own poetry into this landscape. Because the subject is not anymore the landscape, it's the blank nothing. But with this nothing, I create something more. This is why I don't like just like taking landscape, because you question nothing. I need to question something in my photography. So a lot of time I question about the medium itself, a lot of time about this medium it's used.
I was thinking about that music, man. Yeah,
I know. It's like, you're not going to need that shot.
Filmmaker. Well, it means a profession, but it also means that it's also my hobby. So I feel very lucky that I can do my hobby all day long. Potential is, in what we do in the sort of narrative form, is when you get the little piece of an idea which you can see you can develop into something bigger that people will enjoy, or at least some people, hopefully. I needed a fixed camera because I wanted it to be as easy as possible, because it's a long time since I have DOP'd anything outside of a studio, basically. And even then, it's been a long time since. So I put some limitations that would make it a little bit easier for me to control what I could get, and also that I wouldn't go too overambitious, which I have a tendency of doing with small and big projects in general. And then when I met Esteban, it was a natural click, and he got the idea very, very fast.
You want me to be in the same position?
Yeah, it looked really nice. It was very good.
Okay.
Just a little bit higher than what you are, because there's a bush in the way.
Okay, so right there?
Yeah.
Okay.
Come on, give me sadness. Make the audience care.
Scene A, take two. Come on, guys. We need some excitement here. Come on, go swimming. Come on.
Well, it's basically a mockumentary. It's the idea of a filmmaker which shoots nature documentaries that is, or thinks at least, he's on his way to Hollywood at some stage, and he takes his job so seriously and is so involved with the animals that he treats them like humans, he talks to them like humans, and it's become more sweet-natured. It was a little bit cynical in the beginning, but now it's turned into a quite sweet-natured little film, I think, which highlights probably that the animals are a little bit better than humans. An amazing mix, and the variation I've seen over the past 2 days has been incredible. Right now, for me, it's sort of fragmented still. I would definitely come back, and it might sound like a cliche in the sense that when you go somewhere, you're awed. It's a lot of new impressions, and those memories then will fade. But I think in this case, it won't. It's not just I want to come back. I would really love to show my family this, because it's been an incredibly unique experience.
As a young teenager skating, my family had like a Hi8 camera, and so I just would borrow that and got like a crappy fisheye for it, you know, wide angle lens, and would just film my friends skateboarding, and then that eventually turned into I used my dad's old Nikon camera. And that turned into shooting skateboarding. Yeah, I mean, it's funny, like, I mean, I'm not, as you guys have probably seen, I'm not like the most adventurous person in the world. Like my favorite place is my bed. You know what I mean? Like I'm not the type of person that's willing to, you know, wear bug spray and go to the camping store and sleep outside. You know, not that this trip is, but for me, when I hear Galapagos, that wouldn't be a place that on my destination list. Like I never even thought of going there. So for me to be able to come here and see what it's like, I was just curious. I wanted to see what this place was like, and it would be just silly to say no to a trip like that. Since I've been here, my cell phone has been in the drawer for 3 days, and I haven't missed it. And that to me is like one of the most surprising things. I guess coming to the Galapagos has let me let go of things that I'm wound up with at home. You know, like I've seen more wild animals in the past 2 days than I have in my entire lifetime, I think. This isn't a normal place. This is not a normal place at all. I think that would be interesting to go to Santa Cruz and see that. We could get some, talk to some people or see some people. And also, and it sounds like they also want some people represented too, and I'm happy to give that to them. You know what I mean?
Right.
Well, I mean, also, I guess, and like I'm getting the vibe that you guys also want us to go there. Like you know, like you guys want to make sure that we get a well-rounded view of things, but, so, yeah. I mean, I think if up to us, I think it makes sense to go. I think the majority would be wildlife. I've been itching to get some faces, to get some voices and things like that. And like this trip has actually made me realize that where it's, I need something driving me. I need to be talking to people. I need to be filming people. I need to be interacting, which is kind of strange because I'm a shy person. Like I'm fairly introverted, but in terms of filmmaking, I need people in it. It kind of like took me out of my normal life and put me in a place where I have never been before and allowed me to experience things I've never experienced before. And that's when I kind of had the out-of-body experience of like, oh yeah, this is crazy. Like this is something that you're gonna tell your friends about. This is something that you're gonna be thinking about for a long time. And this is something that you're really lucky to be doing right now.
I work predominantly in painting and drawing. So many things. Life inspires me. People inspire me. Ideas, places inspire me. Everything. I can find inspiration in anything, and it can be in an unexpected moment. When you see something or experience something that strikes a chord within you, or like a bell being rung, then you know that it's important and that it's important to respond to it in some way. The coast, it's been a whirlwind. It's been very fast-paced, but I've seen so many amazing things. So coming here and experiencing all the different kinds of landscapes, there's all these kinds of new trees and new flowers and plants and new moss and butterflies that I've never seen before, and each, they're all unique.
Feels very interesting.
Have you done it, Jeff?
Oh.
Yeah.
I feel like I've seen so much in such a little time that I have to process it. I think any time we go somewhere, it changes you. You carry these experiences within you, and it helps you grow as a person. But I would have to say, overall, my experience has been amazing. I would say it's an exciting and adventurous place with unique and tropical places to visit and interesting people to meet. And that was a beautiful experience for me. I'll never forget that.
We're mainly graphic designers.
Art directors.
We do a little bit of video work and...
And we do editorial photography.
Being creative means sort of being able to look at anything and make your own impressions and your own interpretation of it.
So the trip was really beautiful. It was... We experienced so many different microclimates going through. The Andes, really great big mountainscapes. How the architecture also had really blended in with the landscape. Really sort of, seeing how trees became houses and houses became trees, and it's, you couldn't really see anything anymore because it was just so fully packed with all these different plants and trees, and it was really, it was really magical.
I think I prefer like this because it's more wild. Like, the jungle is kind of more mysterious.
And then going to this really incredible market.
The market was incredible. Never felt so out of place in my life, but in a good way. it was just a completely different lifestyle. And the colors and everything, like so much color. I mean, I think for any visual person, it's super inspiring, yeah.
Amazing. They're so, like, can you say succulent?
So rich.
Yeah. When we're in a town and there's like these really bright neon turquoises or like really dark deep reds, we don't really get these colors in Germany at all, or in Europe maybe. Yeah, that was really, really cool.
Yeah, I think like Ecuador is, and especially us, we're like color crazy. We love color as well. So for us, it was wonderful. Like. every, like in Ecuador, the people have a very good eye for color and detail and decoration, and this is really beautiful. And
it was really kind of mysterious, actually, I think.
So like so many things, it's actually very overwhelming.
Works in the space between autobiography and fiction, but the sort of relationship between sort of the ecstatic and suffering, you know, I think I was always kind of drawn to images like that, but also kind of horrified by them, so kind of scared and repelled, but the sort of eroticism within work like that, the depiction of bodies. So a lot of my work is in environments that are sort of enclosed and are humid or wet, and so I was really excited to go to kind of the largest rainforest in the world. But it was also really inspiring and exciting that the thing that actually captivated me the most, in some ways visually, was the movement that was like a choreography, that was like a dance of, you know, the hours that we spent on the canoe with this incredibly skilled canoeist, Carlito Tapue, who, a 23-year-old who's been canoeing his whole life, of course, and goes up and down the same river several hours a day. And so that, in the end, became the sort of thing that I wanted to look at, you know, most closely.
Bienvenidos a la comunidad Quichuañango, al Parque Nacional Yasuní, manejado, organizado por la comunidad en turismo comunitario.
I think what was particularly inspiring and moving with the experience that we had in the Amazon was that this very special initiative of the Napo Wildlife Center, run by the Quechua and Nyango community, is one that seems like it. They manage to. It's a self-sustaining community that, you know, that runs, that where all the they fund all the money from the income of the tourism goes back into the community, and where education is really at the sort of priority of how the whole community runs, and that you know, speaking a lot to the sort of heads of the community, it was really fascinating that the school system, for example, that there are several students who were born in that community, have gone through that school system, and are currently studying engineering and management in Europe, and are then going to come back. And so that sense of actually of communal, the sort of relationship and responsibility that they have to each other as families and as a community as a whole was really moving. It was really interesting how much the relationship to the environment, so this relationship to sort of embracing both worlds, but in the sort of most positive way, I suppose, where sort of realizing that tourism could feed into sustaining the ecology, sustaining the environment, but also sustaining their ancestral heritage. So a sort of emphasis on their own language, on their own traditions, whilst encouraging an education in a much more...
Thank you.
So then you put it in the work.
And then, yeah, but it, I mean, I didn't have that much time.
Yeah. That's what I guess.
For me, the Feel Again project was really interesting because it brought together all these different types of artists. And coming back after our trips and working with everyone and seeing how everyone kind of interpreted the country, seeing all these different mediums.
There's really nowhere like the Galapagos Islands in the world. It's endemic animals, it's endemic plants, and the landscapes are completely out of this world.
Ecuador has more than just what I knew about. So especially like food-wise, it has a really wide range of dishes.
And it was really nice to see the dynamics of what it would be like to not live in a huge city and what it would be like to live in the Amazon. So it was a really eye-opening experience.
Actually, just seeing it in person and going from subtropical rainforest to sunny beaches on the coast to, you know, high volcanic peaks is pretty incredible in a very short distance. Compared to Canada, where I can drive for many, many, many hours and the landscape doesn't change, it seems to change here every 5 minutes, which is pretty spectacular.
And seeing all this stuff through different people's eyes, that was really interesting to me. That to me, as like, I don't really consider myself an artist, but like creatively, it made me look at things differently. And that's an experience that not a lot of people get. And I think, you know, I hope that the video I make, it can be as unique as the trip.
Hello?
Hey.
Hi.
Welcome to Galapagos Islands. For your safety, please remain seated with your seatbelts fastened.
How's it going?
Good, good.
Yeah? Are you different?
I don't know if I'm different. I did some quasi-adventurous things, though. I went snorkeling.
Wow, I can't believe you even did it.
I know. So we go to a different island each day. I saw more wildlife in those 3 days than I'd seen in my entire life. It was crazy. I mean, the animals, they don't give a f*** about you. They just, like, hang out. You can go, like, super, super close to them.
What kind of animals are there?
You know what? I should ask Luis. He's our translator.
El piquero de patas azules, tortuga galápagos. El pingüino galapagueño. The iguanas, which is the same word, right? Lobo marino. That's pretty much it.
They asked me what I knew about Galapagos before I came here, and really, I knew very, very little.
Basically nothing.
Yeah.
Did you read that book at all?
I did. I read that Darwin rode a giant tortoise while he was here.
That's fun.
And he also married his cousin.
Oh, that's freaky.
Yeah. What do you think I should do with the footage? Like, how do you think I should edit all the stuff I got together?
What? I don't know. Isn't that why they're paying you?
But maybe, like, cute animals, some nice music, some people.
Did you meet some cool people at the market and stuff?
Yeah.
Timbolitos, bolios, tamales.
Sí, me parece muy bonito. Privilegio haber nacido.
Soy nativo de aquí, de Galápagos.
This one, like, 8-year-old said that he could do 1,000 kick-ups.
Well, as a landscape painter, I think of the landscape as sort of visual language. And I'm always interested to experience new kinds of landscapes to expand my landscape vernacular, incorporate those into my practice and paint those kinds of landscapes. I have many ideas. It's just a matter of which one, where do I start? I think it's to be in those moments and experience them fully and just think about them, just to let them sink in, how they manifest themselves.
What we've been doing is like collecting things all along the way as we're traveling, like all these things that we were talking about, the fabrics, like the colors, the...
Like stones.
Yeah, stones,
or rocks, or plants.
Or even from the, like, even from we the went healing. To the festival. Or the healing.
Oh, yeah, from the healing. Like, we went, the second day, we went back to the market. We picked up the actual herbs, or the, so we're going to use them. Yeah.
So I think for us, rather than try and tackle the whole thing, you know, collecting these things on our journey, they're like, they're details that were really beautiful for us that represent, you know, the things we experienced. And I think we would like to maybe try and create sort of still life setups in a more abstract way that...
Normally I take sort of lakes and mountains and Arctic scenes, so shooting in the Amazonian rainforest was quite difficult, but I enjoyed the challenge and hopefully I'll...
exactly plan in the way that I usually work, in the sense of location scouting already and knowing the subjects that I work with. I work often with either close family and friends or people that I cast, so in a way with a lot of working out and sketching and sort of set building. So I knew that wasn't possible, but I was excited about sort of being in an environment where I had to react quite quickly. And so I did bring some materials, backdrops and materials to work with, thinking that I might be able to create a set build, which I did in the lodge that I was staying in.
Well, it's basically a mockumentary. And like today, we've written the voiceover that's going to go on top of the images we wrote together today.
Well, no, because like since I'm a director.
Yeah, but he's in a point in his career now where he's going so far and doing what he's doing. We're like 1, 2, 3.
But I know I'll definitely go back to the Galapagos in the sense that it was an amazing experience, but it's one I'd really like to share with both my wife and my daughter.
I'm a storyteller, and there's no better storytelling than nature.
Cut! Okay, can you fly? Come on! Can you fly? Chop, 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 chop!
Okay.
So how did you become a nature documentary director?
When I was a kid, I had a cat, and he used to hunt everything around the neighborhood. Once he brought a parrot, so I started following him with my camera. Then my father had a friend who used to work in the Nature Channel, and he saw my footage, and he said that I had a bright future in the industry.
So this is our money shot. I need you to go very close.
People have no clue about how much waiting you have to do for animals to get ready.
Come on, guys. We need some excitement here. Come on, go swimming. Come on. Come on. Okay. Maybe not.
And I just keep waiting for them. But the thing is, like, you need to be, like, ready. Because when animals get ready, you have to be ready to get the shot. Time waits for no man, neither sea lions.
No, that's good. Perfect. You're such a great actor. Okay, action.
Other times it's a little more difficult and I need to put a lot of time in it into them.
Come on, give me sadness. Make the audience care.
It's so difficult to work with these
guys. And the idea that we had as well was nothing concrete. We weren't like, this is what we're gonna do in the jungle. We just had a sort of a vague concept. I think what we wanted to do was something that was a little bit different.
Slightly different, a little twist on
what people might expect from a rainforest in the Amazon, and also just focus on the little details rather than.
I didn't really have a hard plan. I just started to think of some things that I would like to shoot if I got the opportunity to.
It's all the time, every time I make a project or I take picture, it's like an experimentation.
My idea was to shoot a very short film, between 30 and 90 seconds, probably. A mood to it, a feel to it that is a little bit different from what you would see in a nature documentary. I knew I wanted to try and excerpt something from Darwin's On the Origin of Species. Are very much tied in with the story of evolution and a sort of dawn of a scientific revolution.
From the war of nature, from famine and death, the most exalted object of which we are capable of conceiving, namely, the production of the higher animals, directly follows. There is grandeur in this view of life, with its several powers having been originally breathed into a few forms, all into one. And that whilst this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed law of gravity, from so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful, and most wonderful have been and are being evolved.
Oh, my God,
in the Galapagos, it's been one highlight after another.
The market was incredible.
The trip has been an amazing mix.
You realize that you're part of that universe.
I think what was particularly inspiring and moving.
Cacao, I was blown away.
That really came through, mm-hmm. The warmth definitely. From the people.
I would say at that very moment, I felt free again.
It changes you. You carry these experiences within you.
It's really magical and kind of mysterious, actually.
Starting to get a gist of the person behind the country, Ecuador.